stand and sing with me, How Great Is Our God.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God.
Age to age, sing it.
Age to age, he stands, and time hands, beginning at the end, beginning at the end. The Godhead, three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb.
Sing it out.
Above all names, sing it like you mean it now.
Name above all names, and he's worthy, worthy of all praise. And my heart will sing, my heart will sing, how great is our God. He's the name above all names, sing.
God, the praise tonight. Let's give our great God some great praise tonight. Name above all names, worthy of our praise. He's a lot of things. He's God. He's Christ alone. He's our cornerstone. Let's focus on the words while we sing this and remind ourselves our hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness.
Is built on nothing less,
focus,
than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
Sing that again. My hope is built.
Hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
Christ alone.
Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
Isn't that a reminder we need? Through the storm, He is Lord of all. When darkness hides His face,
when darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil.
He's Christ alone,
oh Christ alone, my cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. And through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
I thank God He's the Lord through the storm. No matter what you're going through, no matter how hard it is, He is still Lord of all. He is still Christ alone. Come on, sing it out. Christ alone.
Christ alone. Cornerstone. Weak made strong in the same.
That's a good place to give Him some praise tonight. Faultless stand before the throne. Like we never did anything wrong, but we know we did. But it's forgiven.
He's Christ alone, my cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. I went through my storm. He is Lord, Lord of all.
Remember the time He's brought you through the storm.
He's Christ alone, my cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Oh, and through my storm, He is Lord. He's the Lord of all.
Christ alone,
He is Christ alone. He's my cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Oh, and through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. He's Christ alone.
Give him a praise.
Amen. You know, the favorite part, my favorite part of that song is through the storm, he is Lord, Lord of all. Amen. That means what you're going through today, he is still Lord over it. Amen. Please join me as we open our service in prayer. Our Father, we thank you so much for today. We thank you for your goodness, your grace, your mercy. Lord, I pray that you help us to never lose sight of that. Lord, I pray that you watch over us tonight, Lord, that you cleanse us of any sin. Lord, remove any distractions, remove anything that may hinder you from speaking to us. Pray for our pastor. We sure do thank you for him. We pray that you use him in a mighty way. And pray that we take your word that you have for us and that we apply it to our lives. We sure do love you, and we thank you so much for being an awesome God. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
Let the church say amen. What a joy it is to be in the house of the Lord. How many of you glad you're standing on the cornerstone? Amen. Leaning on him. He's holding it all together, and we thank God for it. We're going to pray for a few moments, and then we'll move on with the rest of our service. Meet some visitors and just a little bit later, friends of ours. We're glad they're here tonight. But we need God, don't we? In our lives, in our homes, in our families. How about in our nation? We need the Lord. Aren't you glad that if we're saved, we not only need him, we have him. Amen. We're calling on him. So we lift these prayer requests up before the Lord, asking God to move in a special way. Let's continue to pray for all of our folks that are battling sickness and illness. Isn't it good to see Deacon Tibbs here tonight in the house of God on a Wednesday night? We praise the Lord for that. And that's a sign he's getting better. And so we got to pray him all the way back, and we thank the Lord for goodness and grace. We appreciate it. We sure miss him and Anita, and we thank God for every chance that they're here. We thank God for their involvement here at Crossroads. You keep praying for him, but let's pray specifically for the pancreas that God would heal it and have it working properly. We thank the Lord for it. Yesterday morning, Dad went into surgery to address a really 9 millimeter kidney stone, which is big. And it was, the surgery went smooth and they got it. And he's in church tonight, so we thank the Lord for that. And so we pray that God will heal him. He was a little bit too active last time, running the grocery store like he was Superman and everything. So this time he's going to church and going back home, all right? And even got his daughter to chauffeur him to church. So let's pray that he takes this time. We want him to heal right, amen? And then he'll be back in next Tuesday to get the stent that was put in, to get that removed, and then hopefully get this in the rearview mirror behind him. But we praise God for successful surgery, amen? And trust that God will continue to bless. Keep lifting up all of our folks. We saw Lizzie here on Sunday. It was great to see her. She's been through a lot physically. Pray for her, but continue to pray for her daddy too. He needs healing in his body and in his soul. How many know God can handle both of them? Amen. And so you pray for her, pray for him, Timothy Kojo, for God's touch. Continue to pray for Crystal Lambert. We're praying for healing for her of her cancer. Pray if you would for Victoria. This is the daughter of my neighbor. She's in cancer treatment, lifting her up before the Lord. Let's pray for the Banks. They're going to go back to New York, I believe, on the 18th and 19th. I talked to Brother Banks today. And if all is well, he doesn't have to go back. So that'd be wonderful. So let's pray for good results there as he goes to New York, that the cancer is at bay and that God continues to take care of him. Taj is going through treatment now holistically. We're praying that God will bless you, asking God for wisdom as to what to do. So pray for Taj and her cancer. Pray for the Dawkins, lift them up before the Lord. God would give special grace and strength. And others that we're praying for, that God would continue to bless them. Let's pray for our pregnant moms, that God would continue to give them safe pregnancies. And we pray for healthy babies, and that the deliveries would just be smooth with no event. These pregnancies are pretty soon for both Bethany and for Krista. So let's pray for them, that they're coming right around the corner next month. So let's pray that all goes well. And the other prayer request we're lifting up for the Lord. Look on the back. You see our missionaries, three of them that are listed on the back. Details about them. You can pray for those specific needs. How many believe God hears specific needs, huh? So we ought to tell him about them. We don't tell him to inform him. We tell him because we're burdened about it. Amen. He wants to hear it. So these are specific needs. We need our missionaries. We need their needs met so they can help us fulfill the Great Commission. So pray for details about them. And then let's pray for our president, our vice president, our Congress, our troops scattered around the globe, all of our leaders. Let's pray that God would give them God's mind. Amen. Our election and everything's going on politically. How many of you are glad, regardless of who's in the White House in November, that God's on the throne? Amen. So let's ask God for his mind, his will to be done in the lives of those that are making decisions. And then more laborers in God's harvest. Jesus told us to pray for that. So let's pray. Let's be available and pray that God would use us to reach a lost and dying world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. All right, we'll pray for just a few minutes by that clock. You pray in your seat, pray on the altar, pray with somebody else. Use the prayer list, mention other prayer requests that you want to mention among yourselves. We'll just pray. And then after those few minutes pass, we'll ask Brother Bert Dunn, if he will, to briefly close our prayer time in a word of prayer. We'll have our offering. We'll meet our guests. We'll have our music and then our message. And then we'll go home. Amen. So let's remain in the spirit of prayer in the meantime.
Father God, Lord, we do love you. We thank you, God, for the privilege we have to be able, Lord, to come before your throne. We thank you for your love, your grace, and mercy. Now, Father, we pray, God, that you be with the service tonight, God, that you'll bind Satan, put a hedge around the house of God. Lord, we continue to lift up those who are battling with cancer, bereavement, all the special needs, God, that go on in the lives of your people, God. We're so glad, God, that we know the way maker. And Father, we pray tonight, Lord, that you bind Satan, put a hedge around the house of God. Lord, that you'll be in the middle of all that takes place tonight. Be with our pastor, hiding behind the cross, filling with your Holy Spirit. And Father, if there's one here tonight that know not Jesus, that his or her personal Savior, we pray that you save that one tonight. Now, Holy Spirit, take charge, lead, guide, and direct. We love you and we thank you, Lord, for all that you do tonight. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen.
Well, praise the Lord. We certainly thank the Lord for prayer. Let's meet a couple of our guests tonight who are here with us. We thank the Lord for them. Pastor Terry Fenton is here from Seneca Falls, New York. Years ago, every single March, I used to do a youth rally up there on Friday night. I think I remember getting married. I think the week after we got married, we were up in Rochester at Brother Roscoe, and now with you not long after that. And now it's been a couple decades, more than that, since we've been there. And he and his wife and a group of them are here in the D.C. area. Pastor, you all stand up, and let's give them a warm welcome to Crossroads Baptist Church tonight. What a joy. Dear friends, precious people, thank you so much for being in church tonight. Thank you for your faithfulness and friendship over the years. And I trust that this weather gets a little bit better for you all while you're here. It was a little bit better a couple days ago in the rain. Hope it blows on through, all right? Give you some good weather to enjoy. Washington, D.C., we so appreciate you. And then I want you to meet tonight Evangelist Andrew Johnson and his family. We so appreciate him, his wife, Rachel, and their children, Elena, Hannah, June, and the boss, Mitchell. And they travel all around the country, and they sing, and he preaches, and we've been together several times. They happen to be up in this area, and they're passing through. Stand up, all of you. Crossroads, give them a warm welcome tonight. Thank them for being here tonight. We trust the service is a blessing to your heart. Look, we need everybody that knows the Lord to be doing something where they live. Amen. And we appreciate. We are not in competition with these men. We thank God for what they're doing in upstate New York. And these folks come from Texas, but they're all over. And every time they preach the gospel, it's a win for us. Amen. So we thank the Lord. We appreciate servants of God that are living for God. And we so thank the Lord. We are still rejoicing over Easter Sunday. What a day we had. Come on, let's give God the praise. What a wonderful day. I appreciate all of the folks that were here, the visitors that were here. We thank God for the soul that got saved. Amen. And we thank the Lord for what he's doing. Sunrise service was just sweet to be here. And then morning worship service. My, the music, the fellowship. We thank the Lord. Aren't you glad he's alive? All right. And what a wonderful day it was here. So I trust that you'll continue to be in your place. We're looking forward to being back in the building this coming Sunday morning. You'll be in your class, back in Sunday school, 9:45, worship service, 11 o'clock. We'll be back in Philippians chapter 1 dealing with our theme. Maybe we'll get to the end of it this week. But you'll be in your place. Every Sunday is Resurrection Sunday. We thank the Lord. Look forward to this choir. It was great to see all of them up there singing. My, how well they did ministering to our heart. So we're excited about that, and we trust that God will continue to move, guide, and direct. All right, gentlemen, come forward now. Receive our offering for tonight. We thank the Lord for the faithful giving of God's peoples. We pay our tithes and give our offerings for the work and ministry of God's local New Testament church. Freely God has given to us, and freely we give back to God, for the Lord loveth a cheerful giver. Let's give cheerfully to the Lord. We appreciate all of those who gave towards our sacrifice offering this past Sunday. If you were not here or did not give, and need to give, let me encourage you to give. Designate on your envelope, it goes to sacrifice offering above your regular tithes and offerings, in honor of the Lord, his sacrifice for us on the cross, our sacrifice for him. How many of you know we can never pay him back all the way? But if we love him, we ought to be giving, and you cannot give, you cannot love without giving. Amen. So I trust that you will give. In just a moment, we'll ask God's blessing on the offering and to bless the gift and the giver. Immediately after the offering, we're going to listen to the special music and song. Aren't you glad you got a God who belongs to you? Amen. He's mine. That's what the song is going to tell us about. So let's worship as the song is sung, and then get our Bibles prepared for the preaching and teaching of the Word of God. Let's ask, if you could, Deacon Jefferson, if you will, to ask God's blessing on the offering. Yes, Lord. Yes.
In Jesus' name.
Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Bless his holy name. Aren't you glad you can call him yours? Amen. And the world needs to know him, and we need to make him known. Let the church say amen. Job chapter 1, go there in the Word of God. We're here on Wednesday nights and having a time, and we thank the Lord for it. So you get your place in the book of Job chapter number 1. God is good all the time, isn't he? All the time God is good. We're not in chapter 1, we're in chapter 2. Y'all wait and see if I remember, didn't you? I was seeing if you remember. Normally I mess up, y'all call it out. You were testing me, right? Job chapter 2. Didn't have to turn very far. Chapter number 2 of the book of Job. Posing the question tonight, say it with me. Why do what? And here's a book in the Bible that's really going to highlight that thought. It's a question that we face all the time. Maybe you went through something this week, and it wasn't that you didn't think that something shouldn't have happened. You just thought it shouldn't happen to you. And not only that, you had about 10 other names where it should have happened. And how many of you know God's the one that decides to whom it happens? So the last time we were here, we were looking at this passage of scripture and challenged. I believe was I here last week? See, the problem was you wasn't here last week. Well, you don't know because you weren't here. I was here. You said no, didn't you? Were you here last week? You were here, yeah, you sat in the back. You backslid, you sat back there. My wife told me, you and your wife, you talked through the whole sermon, you disobeyed, and that's why you don't know I was here. You weren't paying attention. You don't know nothing I said. Go back and watch the service again. Thank you, I appreciate it. They were here, but they were sitting back there cutting up. Flirting and everything. All right, so last week, we talked about this last week. Job chapter number 2. Let's pick up where we left off. Look at verse 9. Mrs. Job is talking. That's where we talked last week. Let's listen to what she said. Then said his wife unto him, dost thou, next word, still. Come on, talk to me. Dost thou what? Still retain thine integrity? Question. She didn't give him time to answer, did she? Don't you hate it when people ask you a question and then they give you advice before you can even answer the question? Dost thou still retain thy integrity? No answer from Job. Now here's her advice. Curse God and die. Now, if the chapter ended there, that would be somewhat interesting. But it doesn't. It's going to go on to verse number 10. But he said unto her, thou speakest as one of the foolish women speaketh. Next word. Come on, yeah, that's exactly how we said it last week. See, you were here last week. See, you paid attention to that one word in the whole message. That's the only thing you heard when I said what? Say it with me. That's what he's saying. It's absurd that I actually heard you say to me what you just said. What? Shall we receive good at the hand of God? And shall we not receive evil? Next three words. In all this. Come on now. God give us some Christians in 2024 who will still do right in all this. In all this. How many of you got some all this going on, huh? In all this. The Bible said, did, next word, not Job sin with his lips. Now watch this now. God must be getting sick and tired of Christian people sinning with their lips and excusing the sin because of their circumstance. Preach, Pastor. If you've character will continue
even when circumstances go bad. Let the church say amen. Father, add thy blessing to the reading of your word. Cleanse me, empty me, fill me, use me in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you. Thank you for standing. Now in chapter number 2, we're watching Job endure sustained attempts from Satan. Remember, we're calling it sustained attempts in chapter number 2 because in chapter number 1, the devil got clearance to mess with Job in the first place, but not touch his body. Remember, chapter number 1, he touched his farms, he touched his farmers, he touched his finances, he touched his flocks, he touched his family, right? All of this Job discovered in one conversation. He was the richest man in all of the land, and all of a sudden he went from the top to the bottom. He lost everything and discovered the loss all in one sequential conversation. Watch this now, and look how he responded. He worshiped the Lord. Watch this now. When you walk with God and you go through trials, your walk with God will usher your worship of God. Huh? Yeah. And so he worships the Lord. So Satan's coming back, chapter number 2, because it didn't work in chapter number 1. Now, I'm just trying to warn you. If you whoop him, he's coming back. And you don't need anything new when he comes back. You just need to keep the same thing doing that you owe. You've got to keep on walking with God. So chapter number 2 shows us sustained attempts of the devil. And then he moves to what I call stronger attacks. Once again, he needs permission. Say amen if you're glad the devil needs permission to touch you. Thank God that he's on a leash. Amen. He can't do anything that God does not allow. But in chapter number 7, God grants permission to the devil to afflict the body of Job. These stronger attacks, and these stronger attacks manifest themselves in a painful reality. There you are in your Bible and in your notes. Look in verse number 7. It is painful. It is painful. Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord, and who smote him? The devil smote Job with sore boils from the sole of his foot unto the crown of his head. How many know this was painful? Now listen to me. I'm telling you that just because you walk with God doesn't mean you're never going to have any pain. Just because you walk with God doesn't mean you're never going to have any trials. Just because you walk with God doesn't mean that the devil's not going to bother you. This was a painful reaction as a result of a devilish action and resulting in a dominating agony. The Bible says from the sole of his feet to the crown of his head. So top to bottom, through and through, he was in pain. There was no escaping this pain. There was no running away from this pain. It wasn't like this pain came in the morning and left in the evening, came in the evening, left in the morning, had relief and came in. Gone. No. He was hurting all the time. Ladies and gentlemen, listen to me, beloved. If we're going to keep serving God until the trumpet sounds, you're going to have to get ready for some times in your life as a believer. By the way, you're no less saved when you're in pain than you were when you weren't in pain if you were truly saved. You're still saved. You can't lose your salvation. But remember, Job is teaching us that trials are not always a consequence of your Christianity. Sometimes they are a complement to your Christianity. And so sometimes you're not going through bad because you sinned. You're going through bad because you did right. There's a difference between persecution and chastisement. Chastisement is getting whooping. Persecution is for righteousness' sake. Come on now. Job is being persecuted. He's not being judged. He's being persecuted. And God has allowed the devil to do it, suggested Job as being one who could handle it. So this painful reality shows us a pitiful reaction in Job. Look at verse number 8. He's desperate. He's desperate. He's so desperate, he scrapes in desperation. And notice what the Bible says. He took a pot's herd. We learned last week that a pot's herd was a piece of pottery. Okay? Sharp piece of pottery, and he's using that to scrape the boils. How many of you think that sounds disgusting? Well, listen. When you got boils all over your body, you ain't thinking about what's disgusting. You're just thinking about relief. Listen, when you're in pain from the top of your head to the bottom of your feet, you find yourself desperate. I wonder if the Christian life, just as right as it's always been, I wonder if serving God, just as real as it's always been, I wonder if walking with God, just as supposed to be as it's always been, has brought someone to a pitiful reaction where you're desperate, just trying to find some relief, this scraping desperation. Notice the sorrowful destitution. Verse number 8, the second part, he sat down among the ashes. The ashes were a place of mourning, of sorrow, of misery, of weariness, of of aloneness. How many of you know that sometimes when everything's good, everybody's around, but when everything's bad, everybody's gone? You ever been ghosted by people? Huh? I'm talking about when you needed them the most, there was nobody there. And this is where Job is. He's in a painful reality, and it shows up as a pitiful reaction. And to make matters worse, he has to deal with provocative rhetoric. How many of you know that being down ain't fun? How many of you know that as bad as it is to be down, it's even worse when people kick you while you're down? Especially when it's people close to you. Am I preaching? Provocative. What do you mean? What do you mean provocative rhetoric? I'm talking about people that start talking to you when you're going through tough times, and their talk is a temptation for you to sin. Look at me. Look at the pastor tonight. You are prone to say something silly when you're going through trial. Somebody listen to me. You know what that means? That means if the weatherman says there's a storm going to blow through and there are areas in my home that are more vulnerable to penetration, I don't put boards up on the bricks. I put boards up on the windows because the windows are glass and more likely to be penetrated than the wood is. Somebody listen to me tonight. I'm saying you better learn that when the storms of life come in your Christian life, you better board up the areas that are more vulnerable. And there's no area often more vulnerable in the life of a believer than his mouth. We put bits in a horse's mouth, and that strong horse is controlled by a bit. That big ship is controlled by a helm. Listen what James said, but the tongue can no man tame. And too many believers have said what they shouldn't say and excused it because the trial was so big. You don't get a pass on sinning because you're in a storm. Come on, somebody say amen. You don't get to cuss because somebody gets on your nerve. Huh? You can't go off and think God says he's not looking just because the person went off on you. You don't get a chance to throw the Bible out the window just because your enemies aren't keeping the Bible in front of them. Now listen to the reckless statement from his wife. Not his boss. Not his neighbor. His wife. Then says his wife unto him, dost thou still retain thine integrity? I call it this reckless. What do you mean reckless? I mean, it's out of control. It is out of control to say to a child of God, you still doing right? Why is that reckless? Because if you were ever doing right, you should still be doing right. Listen, somebody listen to me tonight. You got to be careful. You got to be careful about people who push you, prod you, lure you into doing the wrong thing just because wrong has been done to you. It's a reckless statement. And here's a ridiculous suggestion. Curse God and die. What is Mrs. Job saying? Listen. Here's what she's saying. Man, you walked with God, honey. You did right. You led this family right. You raised our kids right. You feared God. You hated evil. You went to church. You sang them songs of God. You praised God. You lived. When everybody else in town was doing the wrong thing, you were doing the right thing. You've done the best you could. You tried as hard as you could to live. You've been a good Christian, honey, and now you laying on bed with all them boils on you. It's just not fair. If God's going to do you that way after all you've done for him, quit on him. That's what she's saying. He ain't worth serving no more. That's what she's saying. That's provocative rhetoric. Get ready for it. Get ready for it. The devil will assign some mercenaries to get you to do something foolish when your resistance to foolishness is waning due to your circumstances. You say, oh, I don't believe the devil going to mess with me. Like, he tried it on Jesus. He didn't tempt him to turn stones into bread after he just ate fish and bread in John 6. He tempted him to turn stones into bread after he'd been fasting for 40 days. See, the problem is the devil is more acquainted with some of our calendars than we are. And he's more prepared to defeat us than we are to defeat him. Remember years ago we talked about halting in temptation? Anybody remember that? When temptation comes, you need to halt. And I talked about the times in your life when you're most susceptible to temptation. H is when you're hungry. How many of you say you get tempted when you're hungry to sin? Some of you didn't put your hand up, and some of us know you should have put your hand up. H is hungry. A is angry. Why did the Bible say be angry and sin not? You ever said something you're angry you wish you could take back? L, when you're lonely. Huh? Watch it. Somebody say amen. I don't care how bad you want to get married, girl. You better not get with the wrong guy. You too, fellas. My clock is running out. You better go through life wanting something you didn't have rather than having something you didn't want. T, when you're... God understands I sinned, I was tired. You shouldn't ask me while I was tired if you didn't want me to tell you off. The Bible doesn't change because our circumstances change. So here comes his wife. Provocative rhetoric. It's coming. Somebody's going to say something to you in the middle of your trial to tempt you to sin. I can't believe you're going to let them talk to you that way. I know you're going to get back at them. Why should I? If that was me, anytime somebody say that to you, be careful. If I was you, you're not. It's provocative. Look at number 4 tonight and then we go home. Notice Job's principled response. You better learn how to respond with a principle. Look for just a moment. Let me tell you why the believer needs to respond with a principle. Look here. Because principles are truths based on the character of God that do not change. Can I get an amen? Here's why you have to learn how to respond on a principle. Because you got to make your decisions based on something that doesn't change. Because other stuff changes. Other stuff will change. And when that stuff changes, you start changing with the stuff. And then you got to answer to God. Listen, last thing you want to do is let a fool get you acting like a fool. And then you got to answer to God for yourself. So look at verse number 10. Here's the principal response of Job. But he said unto her, thou speakest as one of a foolish woman speaking. Here's what I call a sharp rebuke. He rebuked her. He didn't slap her. He rebuked her. In other words, he said, what you're saying is foolish. He didn't say you're a fool. He said you're speaking like a foolish woman speaks. Some of you men scared, say amen. Tell my pastor, I got to go home tonight. Can I say something to you? It is possible to be saved and do something that looks like a lost person. Anybody listening? It is possible to be wise and in a moment of lapse do something foolish. Come on now, you ain't been that saved that long that you think you're not a sinner still. Now listen to me tonight. The child of God is going to have to learn how to rebuke foolishness. Put this down. I was riding here just a few moments ago. And the Lord gave this to me just riding in the car. I didn't write it down, so I hope I can remember. Here are the two options for the believer when it comes to foolishness. Here it is. You've got to rebuke it, reject it, and therefore repel it. Huh? Rebuke it means you tell it it's wrong. Reject it means you refuse to accept it. And repel it means you send a signal to drive it away. Now, here's the alternative of refusing, rejecting, and repelling. Here it is. Receiving. Huh? Now, if you receive foolishness, that means you accept it. When you receive it, then you reflect it. Okay? Okay, because now that you let it hit you, now it's reflecting off of you. And if you receive something long enough and reflect it long enough, watch it now, you're going to then start reproducing it. Pastor, what you talking about? I'm talking about people who I knew years ago that were wise that are now fools, and they started being fools by receiving someone else's foolishness and then reflecting someone. They weren't really that bad, but they start getting around a bad person, and now they're reflecting the bad from the other person. And after a while, they done reflected the bad from the other person so long, now they are actually manufacturing their own foolishness themselves. Somebody listen to me tonight. You're going to have to decide in your Christian life. You are going to not let negativity and foolishness dominate your narrative. And listen, the world is negative. The flesh is negative. And if we're not honest, if we're honest with ourselves, some of us are naturally negative. I mean, some of us have just been gifted with the innate ability to walk into a wonderful situation and spot everything that's wrong. It's never half full. It's always half empty. The song was, if the singer was good, the mic wasn't loud enough. If the mic wasn't loud enough, the soundtrack was too loud. If the soundtrack was good, the words didn't show up in time. If the words showed up in time, the auditorium was too cold. If the auditorium wasn't too cold, it was too hot. If it was nice temperature in the auditorium, somebody took your seat. If somebody didn't take your seat, I mean, good, not the pastor preached too long. If he didn't preach too long, you couldn't hear him. If you could hear him, the notes went off on the screen too far. Listen. If you're looking for wrong, you're going to find it. The problem with the believer when I'm bent to negativity is that although I have located negativity legitimately and found it, a negative person is not just someone that locates negativity. A person is someone that locates negativity and ignores all the positivity and inserts the negativity as the theme of the entire scene. Listen, there's a problem with a believer doing that, because you can look for wrong in your life, but when wrong becomes your theme, you got it twisted. Because listen to me, if you're a believer, you woke up saved. Somebody help me preach. You got brand new mercy every single day. The Holy Ghost lives inside of you. You live in a free country. You got a Bible that never, God your Father, Jesus your Savior, Holy Ghost your comfort, the Word of God is your God. Heaven is your home. You got a mansion over the hilltop. You got the peace of God and peace with God. You got family. You got a church. You got the opportunity to serve God. One day you're going to walk on streets of gold and gates of pearls. You're going to see Jesus face to face. That when everything you talk about is everything bad in your life, you begin to ignore all the good that God does. And now, instead of spotting wrong, wrong becomes your lens. See, if you come to church and everything in the church building is dirty, it might not be the building, it might be your glasses. And I'm telling some of you, you need to quit trying to change your world and you need to change your lenses. Because until you clean your lens, you're going to blame everybody else on being dirty. And the problem is, if everything's dirty in your life, it might be you. Wipe your glasses off. That was what was wrong with Job. Job's wife. She looked at where her husband was right then. Watch this now. But she forgot all that God had done before. Sharp rebuke. I got to let you go home. Sound reasoning. Here it is. What? Shall we receive good at the hand of God, and shall we not receive? Look, I got to hurry. Here's Job. Okay, I see what you're saying, honey. God's not allowed to let bad happen to us. He's only allowed to let good happen. Watch this now. It's okay for us to accept the good, but it's not okay for us to accept. In other words, we can pick what God does to us, or we can determine what he does. It was okay when we had 10 kids, had all them farms, had all them flocks, and had all those fine. God was all that in a bag of chips. But the moment he takes it away from us, he's wrong, because he's only allowed to do good. See, that's the problem with that is the spirit of entitlement. See, when I start telling God nothing bad can happen to me, I start acting like God owes me something. Chapter number one, Job said, no, I already told you I came here naked. I'm going to leave here naked. And if I get clothes in between there, I must have got them from God. Because I didn't have none when I arrived. I ain't going to have none when I depart. So if I had some in between, I should be glad that I had any at all. Because I couldn't come up with none myself. What are you going through tonight that's got you mad at God? Like he has some nerve to let you hurt. When that happens, you know what you need to tell yourself? Whew. Thank you, God, for all those days I wasn't hurting. When you go broke, thank God for the days you weren't broke. When you lose a job, thank God for the time you had one. When somebody that you love passes away, thank God for the years you were able to enjoy them. When you get stuck at a red light, thank God for that. Maybe you'd be more thankful for the green ones. When it rains, thank God more when it's sunshine. Listen, the only way to keep yourself from getting down in that rut is to remind yourself the bad may be here, but if the bad is that bad, then the good must have been that good. Steady restraint. This is it. In all this, Job sinned not with his lips. You can't maintain restraint if you don't first have rebuke and reasoning. Here's the reasoning. Shall we not receive bad like receive good? You didn't get it, did you? Philippians chapter 4. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true and honest and just and lovely and pure and of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise. Philippians 4, do what? Do what? Do what? Think. Do what? Think on these things. Next verse. And the things which thou hast both heard and seen in me, do. What came first? Then. See. We got people trying to make themselves do, but they haven't fixed the way they think. Proverbs 23:7, as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. See, if you lose in your mind, it's only a matter of time before you're going to lose in your body and in your mouth. I keep telling myself to stop saying that word. Yeah. The problem is you saying it so much because out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. It's already in there. And it's only a matter of time before it has to come out. You got to fix the inside if you're going to fix the outside. God help us. We're going to have to learn to live by principle. And I'm going to tell you something. You better just decide. I am not going to let negativity dominate me. Listen, you better learn how to shut it down. Talk to it. You better tell. Come on. Some Christians are so negative because they have such a ready ear for gossip. Now you just walking around with a stank face all the time. Because people know when something negative happens, they can tell you. Now you just walking around, what's wrong with you? You got a good life. Yeah, but I've been listening to everybody else's bad life. Negativity. You have to learn how to look for positive. Remember old Pollyanna? Remember that movie? When you look for the good in people. Y'all black folk ain't even seen Pollyanna. So who is that? I grew up in a Christian home. My daddy got saved in Independent Baptist Church. I've seen Pollyanna, all right. Little girl came in town, and the preacher just ripping the church up. She said, Pastor, look for the good in people. You know, if there be any virtue, there's some good in everybody. Now, it's not talking about condoning sin, but we're talking about not characterizing life by negativity. And you're going to have to take even people you love and tell them, I love you, but you're talking like a foolish person. And if God has made sure we receive good, he has the right to let us receive bad too. Because I believe that, no matter what I go through, I am not going to be loose with my lips. Because once I say it, I can't take it back. Father, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for your word, and thank you for your people. Touch us as you have time and time again. Heads bowed, eyes are closed. We'll not come forward tonight, but I wonder how many of you would say tonight, Pastor, God has spoken to me. I want to be principled in my response when I'm provoked by others' rhetoric. Sometimes it's the devil. Sometimes your own flesh will talk wrong to you. How many say, I want to be principled in my, I want to do right even when I'm done wrong. Come on, all over the building. God bless you. This is a battle we all have to face. You're going to get poked. Come on now. Somebody going to poke you. The question is whether you're going to poke back. And in Jesus' name, you can do right. God, help your people. Touch every single one of us. Help us to mind you, honor you, and to serve you. We bless your name. We thank you for being a faithful God. Give us a good rest of the week. Bless our guests. Give them good weather. They may be able to have a good time. Give them safety in their traveling. Bless their ministries. And help us all to live for you even when things go wrong. We love you and we bless you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks for being here tonight. I trust the service was a blessing to you. We have some announcements, just a few other minor things before we give you some details before we go. But between now and the next time we get together as a church, please know as your pastor, I miss you, I love you, and I'm praying for you.
Amen. We sure can learn a lot from Job's response when confronted with foolishness, can we? Amen. Let's thank the Lord for the message this evening. Thank you.
Happy birthday. You know, years ago when I came and I heard that Pastor Emeritus and Pastor Kent was born on the same day, I said, that's remarkable. But on behalf of the church, we just want to express our love for you by giving you a card and something in the card. So we just wanted to say that we love you.
I looked at him, I said, you want to say something? He just smiled. That means no. I'll speak on behalf of both of us. Thank you. Thank you so much. What a joy it is to serve the Lord. I was riding up the road from Tennessee this morning, left about 6 a.m., and I was looking at the mountains on I-81, and I was nervous because I don't like it when my birthday falls on a church night, because these kind of moments embarrass me. So I was practicing what to say, and I don't remember anything that I practiced in the car this morning. But I do want to say thank you, and I want to say that 4 years ago when all this COVID stuff happened, COVID didn't just happen to me. Something happened in my heart, and God has, I'm living in a place right now where I've never lived before. I am at total peace. I have never enjoyed the Lord any more than I do now. And I don't want to do anything in my life but love God and love people. And I'm at a phase of now the next couple weeks and months of busy. So I'm coveting your prayers. But I don't want anybody to feel sorry for me. I just want you to pray for me, that I keep serving the Lord, and I'm enjoying myself. I want to do this. I don't know when I'm going to die, but I'm serving God as if I could die soon. And I want to finish with nothing left in the tank. So I'm dumping it all. Just dumping it all out. So you pray that God will help me. And everything that I am is because of them. They taught me how to be a Christian and a preacher and everything. So I owe their investment in me living for the Lord. So I thank God for my wife and family and dog and everything, you know. But I thank God for this church. I'm living the dream. It's just a dream. A 9-year-old boy had a dream about preaching, and I'm living it. And there's nothing in the world for me. I have everything I need. So thank you for whatever's in here. I promise you I'll use it let me finish, Christine. I'll use it. I don't have anything I want. Somebody said, what you want for your birthday? You know, when every day is so special. What do you want for your birthday? Just another day like yesterday. And so whatever's in here, I'm gonna put it to work so hopefully I can be a better pastor, a better husband, a better father, a better son, and a better Christian. And if you'll pray for me and stand behind me and help me serve God, I promise you, I'll keep serving him, because I told the Lord if I quit to kill me. So you don't have to worry about collecting nothing for my birthday. Just give it to my wife, and when God kills me, and help her with her mourning, all right? She'll feel better about it. Thank you on the behalf of both of us. We praise God for the opportunity to serve God and serve you, and I hope God lets me serve him right here at Crossroads Baptist Church until I die or until Jesus comes.
All right. Well, should we sing happy birthday? Yeah, let's sing happy birthday. Who wants to start it? I'll start it. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday All right, let's stand and say our theme. 2024, more and more. 2024, more and more. You are dismissed. God bless.
Hi, folks. I'm Pastor Kenny Baldwin. Thank you for tuning in to the services at Crossroads Baptist Church. I hope in some way it was a blessing to your heart. Please subscribe to our YouTube channel or follow us on Facebook and Instagram. We'd love for you to keep up with what's going on at Crossroads Baptist Church. He's at work, and we're thrilled that you're a part of it. May God bless you.